Chop, cut, rebuild.
Driving in Alabama to dig up the past isn't always what they portray in the movies. We're here to find something exciting, a piece of American history left for nature to consume, and to meet two men who intend to let nature go hungry.
My name is Ted Stevens, and I'm in the antique Chrysler, Dodge, and Plymouth parts business.
My name is Mark Hedrick. I'm the owner of Auto Metal Direct.
The property covers 58 acres, and there's somewhere between 2,000 and 3,000 cars here.
Well, many times I came over here in the past, and this car was sitting out here as a advertising ploy, I guess. Ted put it out there for people to see when they came by, and it was like a magnet. It stopped a lot of folks to come in here to see what kind of cars were actually in this yard.
It was very effective because it worked every time somebody came to the front door. Is that a real Daytona?
Is that it? Nope. I think we may be able to save the car, but not the tree. Right there. Is that it?
Nope.
Here, is this it?
Nope.
Well, as we were walking through the yard, this car is actually located in yard 3, so it took us a little while to get back there. So every charger we passed, Dan would ask, is that it? Is that it? And I didn't tell him where the car was there, and there was a lot of is that it's before we got to that car.
You know where the car is?
It's out here. Trust me. That's it.
No, that's not it.
Well, when Dan saw the car in the yard, it was, I think it was some excitement, some nervousness. You know, it's a lot of damage, and it's a big challenge.
Well, it's been hit.
Oh, yeah. A police pursuit when it was about a year old, and that's how this happened.
Wow.
And he ended up being a police dispatcher for one of the police departments that were chasing him that night. So, how's that for a turn of events?
Well, I'm glad it turned out that way.
There's a lot of stuff missing off this car. What's not missing, most of it is damaged. If you want to know what AMD parts we're going to use on this car, just open the catalog. It's basically all of them.
Previously, you couldn't fix anything like that Daytona, or you couldn't fix a charger or a roadrunner or anything until we came along, because nobody was making floor pans and trunk floors, which rotted out on almost every Mopar product.
Mark and I have known each other for a long, long time, and we've always worked real well together.
So I guess the big question is, how much of this car is a charger?
The biggest part of it, like I said, these cars were actually built as Charger RTs. These cars were built to homologate the Charger Daytona for NASCAR racing. And the rule for the Daytona was they had to build 500 cars. So they built 503. The parts that are required to convert a Charger to a Daytona basically are the nose cone and the wing. That's the two biggest things, but there's a lot more to it than that.
There are hardly any wrecked Daytonas anywhere. But Chargers, there's hundreds of Chargers back there.
You know, even if it falls off the forklift, we're no further behind.
Okay, what we're doing here is putting the casters on the car so we can roll it, so we can get it into a trailer to get it down to the installation center. We'll put two on the back, one on the front. The right front is too screwed up to put anything on it, so.
It's the world's first Daytona tricycle.
It is.
You're not gonna throw any of this stuff out because you don't know how to throw anything out, right?
That's right. We do not crush cars. We have never crushed the first car, and when we crush the first car, we'll crush them all.
What are the odds that I'm going to get bit by a snake?
Relatively low in the parking lot.
Okay.
We're going to need a bigger box, Dan.
We're going to need a bigger boat. Wow, this thing really was sitting out in the field for a long time. Look at this. Look what I found in here.
Oh, how about that?
Not many are lucky enough to discover a real Daytona. It's a rare find. So the team at the AMD Installation Center were naturally excited about seeing it. When they do, they'll likely be excited about seeing it leave, too.
We're going to need a gang for this.
I brought a gang with me.
Craig Hopkins, owner of the AMD Installation Center. Well, there's been a little rumor running around the shop for a couple of weeks now that Ted Stevens had a surprise visit with a chop cut rebuild project.
I hear Ted brought something special.
Well, I think if you don't mind, I'll probably stand behind you. It might be better in case you collapse. You know, your knees give out when you see it.
And I always like to do it, but when I opened the trailer door, it was a surprise.
I've seen a lot of rust and I've seen a lot of wrecks, but that's a lot of both.
Yeah. Anybody want to hand their resignations in now? No? We're good? Yeah, you just, all right.
But I got to tell you, when the door to the trailer came down, it's hard to get over the shock of a car that's that wrecked.
Well, I got the reaction out of Craig I expected. Like I said, he knew what he was getting himself into. And they fixed cars like this before. Like I said, it's not it may be the worst one, maybe may not be the worst one, but these guys can handle it.
Time to brakes.
So everyone was anxious to see the car go in the air, and I could see in Ted Stevens' eyes, because he had never seen the bottom of the car. But you know what? It was kind of disheartening in a way, because so much damage was on the bottom of the car. You could see how far the impact went back. I'd be surprised if it didn't break the taillight it hit so hard.
Years of neglect have compounded issues with this ride. It's decayed and scavenged. The collision is almost secondary to its other problems.
The car was wrecked in a high-speed police pursuit. The impact supposedly took place at about 100 miles an hour. Judging from the damage on the car, the way the thing wrinkled up and wadded up, I'd say that was probably accurate.
Look at that, still got seat belts.
Yeah. I wouldn't trust my life to them, but it still has them. You know, I was hoping for a little cleaner view of the rear rails. The downside of the dang thing is, after the wreck and it set and got picked apart, it just sat in the dirt, and that's the kiss of death.
In order to get the car to sit up on the table, we had to do two things. One, we had to get the K-member out of the car, and we had to remove the front frame rail.
I know if we do stare at it long enough, it probably will fall off, but should we do something?
I think it's been stared at long enough, so let's see if we can get it to come off.
First thing?
And we gave Ted the honor to make the first cut on the car, because why not?
Well, we started out with a Sawzall, and that was a little bit difficult, so we ended up pulling a torch out. You know, the torch goes right on through all that. The Daytona was, there were so few of them to begin with, so the rarity of it makes it desirable. The pedigree of it with NASCAR makes it desirable.
Some people say, well, you're stepping over the line, you know, you're replacing a lot of metal on this car. Yes, we are. We're still rebuilding a Charger car that is a Daytona car. So I think when you're playing at that level, no, we haven't stepped over the line, but we are saving something valuable. Are we utilizing every trick in the book? You bet we are. One of the disheartening things for me, and a part of the car that I really wanted to put back in there, was the rear frame rails. I had high hopes of salvaging the rear frame rails in the car, and we're still gonna make an attempt.
I'm Wesley Kennedy. I work here at AMD Installation Center in Cleveland, Georgia. Now, when the car came in, it still had the old seats in it, and normally the cars are torn down and been stripped for us, but in this case, this one's coming in, it's got everything, so we had to rip out the old dash and all the wiring, and there was springs broke out of them already, and a rat nest and everything.
What may look like trash and decay is trash and decay, with one exception. It's trash and decay from a Daytona, so Ted will be keeping most of it.
As far as the build is concerned, I'm getting excited. Well, the more we get into it, the more excited I get. I'm not nervous about it because we got good people. We can do this. We've done it before. So this car is a little worse than what we usually deal with, but being what it is, it's worth the trouble.
Mark Hedrick and I had been meeting back and forth on doing something again for Chop Cut Rebuild. And what Mark really wanted was an unusual car. Ted provided that, obviously. But the goal was to have a car that you could see the metal work on. So when this car is finished for the season, it's just gonna be a metaled up car. You'll see basically what you buy out of my shop. Every joint, every weld, you know where the money went.
With all your knowledge, you should become the host of a car show. You'll clean up, they said.
At the AMD Installation Center, Southern Hospitality was about to be challenged by a 69 Daytona.
Morning.
Good morning, Dan. How are you doing?
Good. How are you? Hey, Wesley.
Good morning. How you
you're
doing?
Right in time.
Am I for what?
Well, because I was going to do some chiseling, but now that you're here, you're elected.
Sure. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, good.
Craig Hopkins, owner of AMD Installation.
So, locked in nice and tight.
Okay.
Wesley's going to be cutting up here, and so you're going to remove the quarter panel from the jam, mm-hmm. leaving the flanged edge on, and then we'll come back and I'll show you how to cut the flange off.
So leave a little piece there.
Yeah, leave yourself about an inch right here, and then I'll come along after you and we'll have the 101 on how to get the spot welds off without killing the jam. And that's the secret of the chisel. Today obviously was a chisel day, and the chisel is a great tool for taking the car apart. Dan's got a little skill with it, so we let him utilize it. And he worked with Wesley, but I think Wesley was working him to death.
Hey, I'm Wesley Kennedy. I work here at the AMD Installation Center in Cleveland, Georgia. Okay, today I had Dan working the air chisel. He helped us chisel quite a bit apart, which really wasn't that much on this car. It's just two quarters in the back end. For someone that doesn't do it that often, I thought he did a good job.
Proud of you, Dan. You saved another part of the real car.
Yes, more DNA.
I like it.
Are we going to try and keep this?
Well, the roof rail, yes. Again, we're looking for every piece of DNA we can get out of the car.
Sure.
Just because it is what it is. This car's got a lot of provenance. It's one of 505 cars. So we're making an extra effort because everybody agreed we should. Okay, again, the only reason we cut the panel long. You have to listen to this, Dan. You have to listen.
Oh,
come on.
You told me I'm going to need this.
You will need it. When I got Dan to start cutting on the car, I laid off the quarter panel against the door jamb, and I tried to get him to stay off of the jamb. There's a little flange back there that I didn't want cut off. He did an excellent job. He stayed with it and made good cuts. So what I'm going to do is take the chisel, and I'm going to remove this piece here, mm-hmm. get it started for you. And then talk about how to address the spot welds.
Okay.
And then it's your baby.
Okay.
So now you will need these.
Okay. And maybe another door jam.
Okay, I see a lot of people that try to chisel. They don't understand that you're cutting around the spot weld. You're not trying to cut through it. You cut around it. Most people today, they get the drill, and they get them drill weld busters on there, and they drill like crazy. And half the time they're drilling through the second piece that they don't want to hurt. And that's a lot of times I weld up a bunch of holes that people drilled in flanges because they drill too far.
Okay, so there it is, Craig. It's gone.
Not forgotten.
There it is, missing.
Yeah.
What are we going to do next?
Well, the next thing, I think we take the roof off the car. We'll get a couple of stools over here and get up there, and let's get the roof structure off the car.
Okay.
So the goal for today was to get the car trimmed out to go to the media blaster. The quarter panels came off the car, saving the wheel trim molding. Then the rear tail panel came off the car. The roof panel came off the car. And last but not least is we trimmed the trunk floor out simply because it'll allow the media blaster to get inside the rail.
For sure, all the cosmetic metal is being replaced, but the stuff underneath, there's still some
exactly.
stuff that's worthwhile.
Oh, yeah, we gotta have it.
Right.
We're making such a valiant effort to restore the car and save everything that Ted took the rust with him yesterday in his little hand, put it in a box and put it in his truck and took it home. Unbelievable.
Well, it's off to the blasters. So join us next time for more when there'll be less.
You're watching Chop Cut Rebuild. Understanding the storied heritage of a significant vehicle like our Dodge Daytona is an important part of the process and the fun of building a classic.
Chop Cut has never been afraid of controversy, whether it was the origins of a vehicle, suspension modifications, or a color code. You see, controversy means there's passion there, and there's no one more passionate than the Mopar community.
Tim.
Hey, Dan, how are you?
I'm good.
Good to see you finally.
Thank you for having us.
Well, hey, I'm excited about today. Tim Welburn, Welburn Muscle Car Museum. I've had the museum here for 7 years.
There it is. Yep. That is the engine that built a nation.
That right there, that's the king of all Mopar engines right there, and most any engine ever built. Mopar guys, myself being one of them, we've always been kind of the underdog in the car world. Your Chevys and Fords outnumbered us by many, many. But we had some cool colors, pistol grip shifters, polyglass, big fat rally wheel tires.
So you can save me a fortune on animation. I can just come down here and
we'll plug it up.
This is Ted's car.
Yeah, that's Ted's car, 68 Hemi Charger.
Ted has 5 acres of cars. He's got no room to park a car. He leaves one here with you.
My admiration for the Dodge Charger came from my father. He drove a 1967 Charger, then he went and traded it for a 1971 Charger. That car's here in the museum. That's my favorite of all. When I got 16, those keys were nowhere to be found. And that's why I'm still here and why this car is still here. My dad knew better let a 16-year-old have a 426 Hemi under.
Okay. And what's the story on this car?
Probably one of the most special Chargers in here from color and just beautiful to look at is the 1971 Hemi Charger I have with a sunroof. It has that claim to fame of it actually costs more than a Cadillac. This last year, we decided to restore our old dating car. It's a 1970 Dodge Charger.
Now you've been with your wife since high school.
Yep.
And you've got your same wife and same car.
Yep, there it is.
Congratulations. Tim, this is really why we came down here to see you, was your expertise in the Daytona.
Charger ball. Daytonas?
Yeah.
Well, I've had a few of them through the years, and this one's special. In 1969, when the Dodge Daytona came out, it was way ahead of its time. It was the first true aerodynamic, very stable car on the racetrack. And it was powered by the infamous 426 Hemi engine. One of the more special cars in here, no doubt, is the K&K Dodge that built by Harry Hyde for Bobby Isaac.
And you've got this displayed very nicely with your original car here, and then you go up, and this is the real deal.
Yep, this is the real deal. This is the car that went to Talladega and raced, and it was a Grand National Champion in 1970.
Yeah.
Went to Talladega, broke a world speed record there at 201, then they went to Bonneville Salt Flats and broke 28 land speed records. The car handles beyond most anything today you would see. Why? Because of the aerodynamics.
And this had the same capabilities as the one above me here that actually was on the track.
Yeah, this wing right here and that race wing on the K&K is the same wing. The aerodynamics of the Dodge Charger Daytona was so good that it was outlawed after 1 year, with one exception. You could run it in the 1971 season with a small engine, not a 426 Hemi. The Hemi's been in this car practically the entire time I've owned it. I may have had it 6 months and I went and found a Hemi and put it in it. So to me, it's going to stay in it.
Right.
And I still value the car just as good as any 440 car value-wise, and I have a little more fun with it. These cars made you smile when you drove them, and we haven't forgot that. Times get more difficult, but if we can look at the old car that we used to have or still get to drive the one we used to have, nothing's sweeter.
So we're not any strangers to controversy. We've had this happen over the years with us before about whether a car was or wasn't the cover car, those
right.
kinds of things. Whether
right.
Is there going to be backlash that this car is so far gone that it's no longer a Daytona? Or, I mean, what's your opinion on that?
Well, here's my opinion. A car is never too far gone, number one, to bring back, especially a special bodied car like the Charger Daytona.
Right.
There's only 503 of them to begin with, and we don't want to lose even one of them.
I think you were absolutely right when you said that this is the attraction in Alexander City.
No, I think it pretty much is, especially if you want a used car.
Well, this used to be a dealership.
It did. It's been a dealership all of its life. Still
it,
is.
It still has that feel to it that makes you want to say, come on down here, folks. This weekend, we're going to make you a deal like you wouldn't believe. This plum crazy car is going to be sold so cheap, you're going to think I'm plum crazy. And it's still under warranty.
From Daytona Beach to a Daytona in Georgia, it's a theme you seldom encounter, but if you're going to have a theme, it'd be hard to pick a better one.
So we pulled it to get it all salvaged out and blasted and primed up.
Get it blasted inside and out.
Morning, guys.
Hey, Dan, how you doing?
Good.
Morning.
How are you?
Hey,
good.
Dan.
How are you, Wesley?
My name is Wesley Kennedy, and I've been working here at AMD in Cleveland, Georgia for about 3 years now.
Wow. It's no better than when I left it.
It might be a little worse.
Is that right?
Sometimes you got to wreck it to fix it, right?
Well, I think the record part was taken care of.
I would agree.
Before we got it.
Name's Aaron Hopkins. I work with Automotive Direct, and I'm our technical service representative.
I thought this went to the blaster, though, right?
Yeah, I went to the blaster, and we blasted the areas that we thought we could reuse.
Oh.
And they're painted in black now.
Okay.
Today was our goal with the Daytona was to bring in a couple of original pieces, get them sandblasted and ready to install on the car.
Well, you know, we're going to get the guys that say this isn't the car anymore because we've put so much
a new product on it.
It's going to be a great car when it's finished. We always have our haters, but hey, the finished product's going to be awesome, so we're going to be in good shape there.
Yeah. So what are we waiting to do?
We're waiting for Ted to get here with a few more parts.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe we should sit out front in the porch and do a little Georgia waiting time.
Let's do it. He's in Alabama time.
Okay.
In some places, people live to work, and others, they work to live. Regardless of the process, the quality of the work is ultimately what will be judged by others. This isn't going to be a rush job. It's only one of 500 Daytonas ever made. Time to breathe is really time to enjoy the journey.
Morning.
Morning. My name is Ted Stevens. I'm the owner and operator of Stevens Performance in Alabama. Game plan for today was to get the frame rails here, get them cleaned up, get them stripped, ready to go to the blaster so they'd be blasted and primed and ready to be put into the car, which happens in a day or two.
Wesley, do you want to do this or supervise this?
Well, I'll do this one because it's got more stuff to come off.
Okay.
And I'll supervise you doing that one. How does that sound?
That sounds fair. Let's get some stuff.
Yeah, Dan and I let him take one and I took the other.
All right. And then from this point forward, I'll be listening to you intensely.
And I'm going to do this one while you do that one.
Huh?
The components, the rails and the hinge pillars came off cars in the salvage yard out there. They were chosen for cleanliness and nice straight pieces, nice and clean.
The original frame rails were completely wasted in this Daytona we're working on because it had taken a really big front end hit. So they were not only smashed to bits, they were completely rusted out.
This Daytona is really worse than most, not just because of the wreck, but the fact that it sat in the salvage yard for years and parts were being cut out of it.
Used Charger parts can also be Daytona parts. Abused Charger parts can also be scrap.
So how am I doing?
Oh, you're doing good. You're a little slow, but you're doing good.
Well, I have to work harder because you know how to work smarter.
I've done it a few more times, probably. I told him, let's see who can do it the fastest, and of course, I'd beat him by a little bit.
Once we got all the pieces cleaned up, all the excess metal off, they went to the sandblaster to be cleaned off.
The reason why we take a car over to the media blast on a project like this is because we want to get rid of all the corrosion.
If you've never been to a rural part of the South, you need to sit up for a moment. I'm not sure why these guys need sand to do their job. Their charm could make rust want to leave.
My name's John Patterson. I own and operate Black Mountain Sandblasting.
John turned this former chicken farm into a restoration salvation, and if old metal can be saved, John and his son will testify to it.
I'm Larry. I'm the sandblaster for the company. Those rails is actually pretty easy considering what I've done in the past. Any other time, you know, we've gotten rails, you know, where there's hose and everything else shot in them. I'm sandblasting. These right here is a nice, smooth finish.
I've said the exact same thing 100 times before. He said smooth finish, right?
I'm glad we're at this point. The car's fixing to start coming together now, and it'll come together quickly. We've done a lot of work to get us here, so it's time for Wesley and the guys to put it together.
It's a well-known fact that if you're going to be playing with cars at some point, you're going to be playing in the sand.
The Daytona's a special car, and salvaging used parts from 69 is a priority. But the fact is, there isn't enough quality used stuff out there that isn't already rusted or damaged. So selecting the best quality replacement parts is vital. AMD makes sure quality isn't a question.
If you've been following along with us over the years, this place is going to seem a little familiar to you. We're at the AMD Distribution Center in Buford, Georgia. We've taken parts from here for Novas, Chevelles, Chargers, Challengers, Cudas, even trucks. But in all that time, we've never really asked them about the origins of the parts, what they've done to decide what part to make available to you when you need a restoration. The popular restoration projects like Camaros, Chevelles, Chargers, and Challengers make it really easy to determine what brands you're going to make parts available for. But the specific parts, well, sometimes Mother Nature gives you that answer. A big part of this industry is ongoing research and development, bringing new products to market. And a company that does more than just make fenders for you is really the company you're gonna wanna deal with. The brackets behind those fenders are vital, right, Aaron?
That's right.
How you doing?
Good. My name's Aaron Hopkins. I work at AutoMel Direct, and I'm our technical service rep.
What do you got here?
This is the back glass for our Daytona project. I'm just kinda going over it, making sure we have the right date code before we send it out to the plug manufacturer.
So you're making a glass for a vehicle that only had 503 or 505 made in total.
That's right.
And you're date coding it.
Correct. This is the only piece of glass we date code because of the rarity of the car. When Dan dropped by today, the plan was to pull all the parts for the Daytona, take a look at the warehouse, and talk a little bit about development. Auto Metal Direct is a supplier of aftermarket bumpers, sheet metal, and glass. And what we do is mainly Mopar, General Motors, and GM truck line, mid-60s to mid-70s.
Now, this list is the stuff that Ted couldn't find or couldn't supply, right?
Correct, yeah. We've got a list here that are items that were either too rusty or too far gone that we couldn't get, so we're going to supplement with our aftermarket product.
Because it's never too far gone.
That's right. When Dan showed up today, I was inspecting the rear glass for the Daytona, and this is a really special piece of glass. No one in the industry has made anything like this. It's a limited run of the car, so we don't plan on selling a ton of this glass, but it is available for those consumers out there.
Oh, we're definitely in the hood now, huh?
Most definitely.
Hoods and roofs and fenders. So these are big ticket items, right?
The main reason why people are going to come in here and buy a part from us to replace their existing part is corrosion. You know, you're dealing with 30, 40-year-old cars. Rust and steel go hand in hand.
And bad drivers help.
Fenders and bumpers, definitely.
So you got your own little mini salvage yard here?
Yeah, sometimes you got to wreck stuff to make it right, you know. So Dan and I were looking at some pieces we're developing currently. When we develop a piece here at Auto Metal Direct, we try to find the best possible example. That way we get the best possible part. Actually, this was went over as the original sample. Mm-hmm. And what we've done here is we've got our first prototype.
Have you ever bought a car just to get one part?
Definitely.
Really?
Yes. Sometimes you go search, and the only car you can find, you have to buy the entire vehicle just to get a quarter panel.
That must hurt sometimes.
When Auto Metal Direct develops a piece, and we take it to the foundry to create the tooling, we'll get a prototype back. Sometimes we'll send it back three different times to make the corrections that we need to produce that high quality part. But we've got a good manufacturer that works with us to make those changes happen so that when we do go into production, we know we're producing the highest quality part.
All right, now is this our Daytona order?
This is our pile. We got two pallets full right here.
This is a lot.
The car needs a lot.
Now I look at a part like this and I say, this is really a demonstration of the commitment you guys have to helping people get the carb completely restored.
Definitely. A lot of development went into this piece, a lot of test fitting. You're way into the car if you're gonna fit this entire piece, but when you've got a car that's completely wasted or crashed, mm-hmm. you're gonna need that piece. Most guys are just ecstatic when they get our pieces because they're looking at a brand new piece of metal that matches the OE.
I wasn't planning on this much, but I think we can fit it all in the truck.
So we had a couple pallets of parts there, about 60 pieces or so. So Dan, Dustin, and I loaded up the truck, got everything strapped down and ready to go so we can take it up to the installation center and get that Daytona project going.
All of this is so much more than a load of parts. This is a message that says we've turned the corner. We don't have to keep tearing down. We can start building our Dodge Daytona.
Good morning, Dan. How you doing?
Good. What's all this?
I'm Wesley Kennedy, and I work here at AMD Installation Center as a lead car builder. Before Dan arrived today, I was setting the table up, getting ready to build on.
Well, I brought all this stuff. Is there anybody else here? Is it just me?
Just you and me.
Oh, no, that's not going to last, hang on.
And we had a truck come in with a load of parts, so he called a couple of guys from the warehouse to come up and help us.
Hey guys,
morning.
Wow, that was fast.
How are you?
Good, how about you?
Good, good.
My name is Aaron Hopkins. I work for Auto Metal Direct, and I'm our technical service rep.
My name is Dustin Goodwin, and I handle the customer counter. What was cool about coming down here was it was just something totally different than what I'm used to. I got to get my hands a little dirty and just help out with the guys with the build.
What's the front and what's the back right here?
Okay, that's the front of it.
Yeah.
Front of the car and the back. First thing we did when we got started was got the frame rails and the torsion bar cross member into position. Dan, could you hand me those two bolts there?
All right.
How about if we put the frame rails on the correct side though?
Yeah, that might be better.
So here at the installation center, they use a jig system. Basically, it replicates the bottom of the car. And we have dowel locators that we put the frame rails in place, pin it with the dowel, and that way we know it's accurate to the original specs of the car.
Our main reference points are right here where these holes are. When we can pin the hole and Everything works. Everything's laid out in the right place. Well, the tables are true denim lines for the car. Even if the table wasn't level, the car would still be level to the build because of the way the table's made.
So once we had located the front frame rails and the cross member, we moved to the back of the car to locate the rear frame rails. That way we had the bones of the car together, tied them together with the inner rockers, and then we had a frame of the car.
Building this Daytona has been a little different. It's a wrecked car on top of a rotten car, so it's like twice the trouble.
So Dustin, Wesley, Dan, and I, we had a really good time with this build so far. It's nice to get to the part of the project where you actually see stuff coming together.
So this is the original part off the car, but it's all pitted.
Right.
So it's not really what you would want with a quality restoration. The issue is, this is the original DNA.
On the Daytona, we're not able to keep too many of the parts, mainly because of rust on one side and the wreck on the other. The only exterior part we've been able to keep is the outer rocker on the driver's side.
Balance is everything with this build. New AMD parts are available, but originals are sacred.
So we're getting it kind of mocked up into place.
Yeah.
Just to see where we're at. Got my little laser here we can turn on.
Okay.
And this will give us an idea of how level we are. You can see it right here, those holes.
Oh.
That's the level. Today was a mock buildup on the floor systems for this car. This car is so far apart and has so many pieces to it. I want to make sure everything goes together good. And I got a good feel for it today, the way it went together.
Craig and Ted want to make sure that as much of the original car is used as possible, right?
Right.
So it's about keeping that DNA. The rails, the front rails, are original.
Original, shock towers, bracket.
This, uh-huh. This is all new metal from AMD.
Firewall and this whole floor system.
Okay, this rocker is?
Original to the Daytona.
But that one's not.
That one's not.
So really, Ted's car ends here.
Pretty much.
There's nothing that's old from there back.
Just a few little pieces they're trying to salvage.
Oh, those, okay. So these have been down in assembly line. Well, no, this one piece hasn't been, I'm sure of it. The Dodge Daytona took a horrendous hit early in its lifetime. The difficult thing, though, is to determine who's taking the hit now, the guys restoring it or the owner. Hey, guys. Morning.
Oh, morning, Dan. How you doing?
Good.
I'm Craig Hopkins. I own the AMD Installation Center.
So where's our car? We got to get going.
It's sitting right here. You were late, so we already put it together. I guess you don't have anything to do.
You know, I always like to kid around with Dan. He likes to kid anyways. So when he came in, we had the call together and told him he came on the wrong week and we had finished it.
What, I mean, this looks like you're almost done.
It's a mock-up.
Okay, so.
We have to mock the car to make sure everything will work before we weld it.
So we're gonna blow it all apart.
Now it's gonna blow apart. You're here, welding's gonna begin.
Oh, that always works out well when I'm the welder.
You're the welder.
I think I need your help.
I'm Wesley Kennedy and I work here at AMD Installation Center in Cleveland, Georgia. First thing I had Dan do was help me take the quarters back off the car. We got all the clamps off and the screws off and the quarter's still on the car fairly tight. And that's because the quarter lands in between the deck lid hinge and the deck filler, sandwiched in there. So you gotta unhook it from the front of the B pillar and then slide it back off the car instead of coming straight off. Once we had the quarters out of the way, we went ahead and dropped the front fenders off.
Them bones. That's what that is. It's them bones now.
Yeah.
We're leaving the doors on?
Yeah, we leave the doors on because when I put the quarters back up, I got to make sure they fit.
You have a reference. Okay. All right. So let's get the welder.
Once we had all the metal out of the way, Dan brought in the spot welder and we got started on welding in the wheel housing.
There you go, doctor. Crash cart. I think the owner showed up when I was out in the parking lot there.
My name is Ted Stevens. I run Stevens Performance in Alabama. I am the owner of this Daytona.
How you doing?
You want to work the welder a little bit? Dan says it wears him out.
Yeah, I'll take it when he's breaking or something.
You know, one of the unique parts of our business is we use a three-phase liquid-cooled spot welder. So when they got ready to weld the car up, we plugged it up, we made the adjustments. Because an extremely intelligent welder, all you have to do is program it, and it'll give you the perfect weld every time. Really, Dan had no problem using the welder. It was telling him what to do.
A welder of this caliber makes a significant difference to the quality and originality of a restoration. Plug welds can do the job, but they're not replicating the factory look, and they add hours to a job that could take minutes to complete.
One of the high points for me was watching Ted actually shoot welds into his own car. He had an opportunity to do something that very few people do. He welded his own car together.
You know, we specialize in taking stuff apart, not putting it together, but Wesley's a good instructor, and I think I'm a panel spotter now.
You know, what we're trying to do at the AMD installation is we're rebuilding the car body. And in order to do that, we obey the original engineering on the car, and we duplicate the spot welds that the factory put in the car. Obviously, the value is in its originality.
We don't want to do a modern upgrade on this car. There's a lot of stuff out there to do that with now. But this car being a Daytona, I think we need to put it back the way it was. Everybody has their own opinion on a rebuild. How much of the original car went into the rebuild? With this car, everything that we could possibly use went into the rebuild. We're not adding any numbers to the 503 that they built to start with. It's not a clone.
Craig and the AMD team have a three-day strategy to turn this car back into a Charger. Back end sheet metal, front end, and the roof. After that, there's a whole new strategy to turn it back into a Daytona. Some cars have a unique look and some have an acquired taste, but few have a unique look applied to an already tasty package. Mopar wing cars certainly achieved the goal. In 1969, NASCAR's rules for competition required manufacturers to produce over 500 vehicles in order to get on the track. Dodge came out with the Daytona and produced 503 or 505, depending on who you talk to. They changed the rules on them because the car was so dominant. So the rule now became, in 1970, that you had to produce one car for every dealership that you have. So over 1,900 Superbirds came along. They changed the rules, but they didn't change who was in the winner's circle.
Morning, guys. How are
hey,
you?
Hey, Dan. Good to see you, man.
Good to see you. Hey, Ted.
Hey, Dan. How are you?
Good. Wesley? So are we all ready to take on day two of the three-day strategy?
Yeah, but day two is going to happen a little bit quicker because I don't want to fall behind, so I'm going to get everybody involved in the build. My name's Craig Hopkins, and I own the AMD Installation Center.
Okay. All right. Well, with all of us and Ted here to help, we'll go fast, right?
I'm out of here. I got cars to take apart.
Okay. All right. Well.
Hey, good to see you again.
Yeah.
Craig? Fun.
Make sure when you come back, you bring a nose.
Will do. Take okay. care of my baby.
I will. All right. Well, let's get the tools and stuff.
Let's get the guys. Today, just to get a little heads up on the car, because we have to finish this car. We only have a little bit more to do. We employed most of the crew.
I'm Wesley Kennedy, and I work here at AMD Installation Center in Cleveland, Georgia. Today, we're just going to clamp up the car and use the spot welder mainly. There wasn't a whole lot for Dan to do, so we let him control the clamps. He brought them in and took them out for us.
In the industry, the media industry, they have best boys, grips, etc. Today we had clamp boy. You almost have to have a PhD to be clamp boy. I mean, because there's two carts and multiple clamps. It could get confusing.
He took the job very seriously, maybe too far. At one point I noticed that he was actually counting the clamps and lining them up in line to make sure they were all there.
Well, that's because any job worth doing is worth doing well, or not.
Today, Craig brought in Cesar to help me weld, which is kind of nice because I've been on the back of the car all day trying to get everything lined up, and Cesar came in and welded the front.
So the first thing you notice when Cesar and Wesley began welding the car is they double-teamed the big welder because it's heavy, maybe in the 45, 50-pound range, and it just works better to have two people do it. After they got it where they could change the head and Cesar could run it by himself, Wesley took over on the MIG welding. Cesar's been with us for about 10 years. He came to us right out of high school, and he took to it like a duck to water, and now he's at the skill set where we can throw anything at him and he can build it. You notice that he did it in a sequence, in a pattern. What it does is allowed us to make sure we're putting the proper amounts of welds in the right areas of the car.
Yes, Cesar has an uncanny level of skill and control with the spot welder.
The sheet metal in the front of the car is pretty important. We have to center up all the shock towers and all have to be centered to the car, so when the suspension comes up onto the car, it's centered with the car and the frame. On the front of the car, where our MIG weld is down low, the lower core support, It comes to the frame rail in there, and there's no way to get our spot welder in there. It's boxed in, so we can't pinch it. So there's some places we do have to MIG weld. And our 3-day plan to finish this car up is pushing it just a little bit. We're gonna have the front end all welded today, and the back end's almost all locked into place.
Really looking forward to day 3 simply because we're gonna cap the car, which means the roof's gonna go on. Now, it'll be a Charger when we finish, but then when Ted comes back for the next trip, it's gonna make the transition into Daytona.
Clamps, who needs clamps? Clamps, get your clamps here. Who needs clamps?
First thing on day 3, we're getting rid of clamp board.
Hey, Wesley.
Yeah, Dan?
Clamp 42 is missing.
Oh, I thought I turned that in.
You signed it out, but I don't see your signature here that it came back. Mm-hmm. You know, look, I don't make the rules. I'm just following them like everybody should do, mm-hmm. You know? Go look in your toolbox and see if it's there.
Mm-hmm. And he's taking it away. He says.
Hey, the rules are for everyone. They're right here. Everyone can see them.
Welding up the body on a 1969 Charger is no big deal for the guys at the AMD Installation Center. They do it all the time, and with parts that fit this well, it's a no-brainer. The real challenge is going to be the next step, when we turn a Charger into a Daytona. That is uncharted territory. But for now, day 3 of 3, pretty much sure we can get it done.
I'm Craig Hopkins, owner of the AMD Installation Center. The object for the shoot this time was a 3-day plan on the car.
Morning, guys.
Yeah, morning, Dan, how you doing?
Good.
And really revolved around getting the back end of the car up and then doing the front end, terminating with the roof.
Do the back, we do the front, and now we do the middle?
Got to meet in the middle sometime.
Okay, so it's like dancing. You got to go 2 steps forward and 1 back. Welcome to Dancing with the Cars.
We've got the rhythm. Well, the first thing that Wesley started on to bring the car back together was to start welding on the rockers.
I'm Wesley Kennedy, and I work here at AMD Installation Center in Cleveland, Georgia. Today is our final day of the build of the car. We're gonna try and get the quarters all finished all welding up and the rockers, and then lay the roof on and be done.
There's intricate work Wesley needs to do before we can install our roof, things that hands with years of experience do well.
Well, that looks good. You're getting the striker on already.
Yeah, getting.
Wow, all this is spot welded?
Listen, I have to go to a really big executive meeting down at AMD. They want me to go down there and take part in this thing for some reason. I don't know why. You'd be all right without me?
Yeah, I think I can handle it.
Okay, all right. Don't, you know, leave too many of those clamps lying around. I'll be back as soon as I can.
All right.
Okay.
We were a couple hours into the day, and I think Dan was getting a little bored picking up clamps, and there was a meeting at the warehouse he needed to attend, so I lost him for a couple hours.
There's always high-level executive stuff to do when you're a TV producer.
So then I told Wesley, there's no way I can get out of this meeting. I gotta go here today. And he bought it. He's still up there welding like crazy.
I had to do it.
Thanks for the burger, Mark.
Okay, maybe it isn't always high-level executive stuff. Sometimes there's a salad you have to eat, too.
Hey, that
hey,
looks
Dan.
Good.
Yeah.
Oh, nice. So you're finishing up all of that down there.
Yeah, just a few more spots.
Well, I am glad that I went to that meeting, I'll tell you. It was really important, to attend a meeting like that.
I was a little suspicious when Dan got back from this meeting, because I smelt relish on his breath.
With much needed fuel in the furnace, including relish, it was time to lift the roof panel. It's flimsy, so many hands keep it positioned properly.
Once I had the rockers and post all welded up, then it was time to prep the roof area. Dan and I got Cesar and Craig to come help us get the roof set up into position.
My name is Cesar Briseño, and I'm a technician at AMD Installation Center.
When you're positioning a roof, it's pretty common to clamp it down, let it loose, move it a hair, clamp it down again. It's just part of the process.
Oh, you got the spot welder all set, ready to go, huh?
Indeed.
So what do you need me to do?
Absolutely nothing.
Perfect. I do that kind of work all day.
The thing about the welder is that it gets a little heavy after you start using, especially being higher on a level. It's a little heavy to carry it to the top. And since I'm a little younger, you know, I have to have a little muscle going through there.
The roof install is always about a 1-hour job just for the weld up. A lot of prep goes in before that. We use Jim on the inside of the car to help the spot welder, and then he just decided to hang out and hold the cord, which was cool. I get a question all the time. Are you over-welding the car, under-welding the car? What we're trying to do is duplicate what the factory did. The engineers had designed so many spot welds in a certain area to carry a load. That's what we're duplicating. So I would say we're right on target.
Working on this Charger is pretty exciting for me because we really don't have a lot of chances and opportunities to work with this kind of car. That's a true Daytona. So I'm very excited to see the whole car finished up afterwards.
A fully welded up car, that's a big step forward. Dodge used the 1969 Charger as the basis for the 69 Daytona. So in order to have a Daytona, you need to have a Charger first. We pretty much have a Charger, time to turn it into a Daytona.
My name is Gary Beinecke. I'm from Sharon, Massachusetts. When Dan showed up today, we were finalizing the fitment of the rear window plug and getting ready to tack weld it into position.
And this is the famous plug.
Yes, it is.
And you hand make these?
Yes.
One at a time?
One at a time.
And does this transfer over to the Superbird?
No, it's Daytona only.
So there's only like 500 that you'd ever need to make for these things and clones.
And clones. Dan, we knew you were coming, mm-hmm. So we have all your stuff here for you.
Oh, look at that, okay.
If you can remove all the EDP on the edge of the plug area, okay. I'll go over to the plug and finish prepping that.
Okay, Ted, I don't want you to think this is a competition between you and I, but it is.
My name is Ted Stevens. I run Stevens Performance in Alabama. We bought this car from a gentleman across the state probably 20 some odd years ago. Even though it was wrecked and rusty and all that, it was basically bought for a conversation piece.
Am I winning?
No.
You both did a nice job.
Gee whiz.
Dan, why don't you put that plug in place and we'll get this thing welded in.
All right, like this?
Yep.
All right, this looks like it's gonna require some expertise.
Yep, we'll bring in Mark. Dan, this is Mark Coates.
Hey, Mark.
Dan, how are you?
My name is Mark Coates. I run ABM Restorations in Kingsport, Tennessee.
Mark will take the car back to Tennessee after work here is done. Daytonas were built to win, and bringing it back to its original purpose is just as important as its original look.
So after the plug was in place, we decided we'd test fit the wing. All three components of the wing, the two verticals and the horizontal, are actually airfoils, meaning that one side's flat and the other side's curved.
The curve part, does that face the trunk or does that face up?
Faces the trunk.
Okay, so then this is the top.
Correct.
Okay, and what does that do?
Well, technically, the air has to speed up to meet the same air across the top. And when it does, that speeding air lowers pressure.
Okay.
And when that pressure is lower, creates the downforce.
So there's lower pressure under the wing.
Higher pressure above.
Higher pressure above.
Pushes the car down.
The engineering in these cars was truly revolutionary. Horsepower can add muscle, but the wind maximizes where the muscle goes.
Installing the wing and the plug and the nose, you know, the car, in a matter of a few hours, becomes a Daytona. Up to that point, it looked like a Charger. So it's pretty exciting to see that conversion happen in that short span of time. Of course, there's been a lot of work and preparation that's gone into that.
That's a lot of weight that's on these quarters.
Yeah, this wing weighs in at 43 pounds.
Don't guess at it.
No.
43. Okay.
Yeah, but that's not including the downforce. The downforce, if it generates 200, 300 pounds, that's all going down to the skins of these quarters.
So what's taking that?
Well, they incorporated was a large four-hold wing washer, steel washer, that supports the quarter. Okay. And they also have a wing brace that takes the load and transfers it down to the trunk floor.
A big wing may add air to the meal, but cutting the air needs to be done up front. The nose plays a big part in dining at the winner's circle. It's the knife that allows you to put a fork into the victory.
It's more nerve-wracking assembling these nose cones. There are a lot of different components in there, and it takes hours to adjust the headlight doors so that they fit perfectly within the opening. Sliding the bumper cone on, pre-assembled, knowing that it is perfect the way it is. It just slides on like you're putting a bumper on.
I'm in the engine bay as they bring the nose in, because you really just get one shot to sandwich several pieces of the nose together, so kind of important to get in there the first time or you're going to be doing it over and over and over again.
It's exciting to see the car finally in its original silhouette. It is a Daytona. It's always been a Daytona, and now it looks like a Daytona.
Well, I guess looks can kill, because this is one killer look.
Spoiler alert, a little suspension and we're ready to tour.
It never fails. As deadlines get closer, teams begin to expand their rosters. Playoff time is getting close, so you have to be prepared for injuries, even paper cuts.
Oh, what is this? We can't send the car out the door without the Hopkins brothers.
How you doing, Dan?
How are you, Popeye?
I'm back.
Yeah, how are you?
Morning, Dan. I'm well.
I'm Craig Hopkins. I own the AMD Installation Center.
So what are we going to do? We got to get suspension. This thing's going to go on the ground, right?
So suspension is going to roll today. It's banner day.
Out the door.
Out the door. You want to see the suspension? It's all done. They did a great job. Right over here.
Okay. They really did a nice job. Morning, guys. So everything new looks old again.
Everything old looks new again.
Oh, okay, all right. So.
Thanks to Mr. Coates, that thing is, it looks just like the factory assembly.
Is this a brand new K member?
No, it's actually an original K member.
Oh, okay.
My name is Ted Stevens. I run Stevens Performance in Alabama.
All right, well, this goes in first?
Control arm's going first, and then this goes in.
Okay, let's get it over there.
Well, Dan got here this morning. We had the suspension system laid out, the front K-member assembly and the rear axle assembly ready to go up under the car. Assembly of the front end went pretty well. We had one torsion bar, kind of gave us a hard time, but they're notorious for that. Some of them just fall in, some of them you got to beat them in.
My name is Paul Hopkins. I'm a retired carpenter. I live in Redondo Beach, California. I'm up here helping out my brother Craig with their AMD project.
Well, Popeye's the oldest guy in the room, but he likes to use a hammer, so we let him whenever he wants to.
I'm Gary Beinecke. I'm an attorney, metal fabricator, car builder, and designer. Installing the K-member in the front end has some difficulty because you're trying to install all of the components, a very heavy and awkward part.
So is that everything on the front end that we have to do right now?
No.
No, we have to do what?
Well, he's going to put the control arm to the spindle over here like Gary's already done on this side.
Okay.
And then the torsion bars are going to go in, and then the steering column is going to go in the car, and that's pretty much the front end of the car.
The torsion bar installation can be difficult because you're trying to clock the torsion bars. They have a six-sided flats on each end.
You know, right now we're having an issue getting the torsion bar in the car, and they register on a hex on both ends. So the torsion bar cross member is affixed, and the suspension is movable. Right now the suspension isn't down far enough to get that torsion bar into.
The rear end, again, we installed using AMD's rear end support. What that allowed us to do is to install the springs, the shackles, and the front mounts, roll the rear end into the car, attach the front mounting points first, and then just raising the rear of the springs up and hooking the shackles up.
All this grunt work does pay off when you put a cool set of wheels and tires on, and we have a cool tire and wheel package waiting.
Ted, that is an absolutely gorgeous wheel and tire package. Is that original looking?
Yep. These are reproductions of the originals, original tires and wheels.
Okay.
From Coker Tire in Chattanooga, Tennessee. These are bias belted tires, just like what they put on the car in 1969.
Really?
When Ted unveiled the tires, they had a few more things to do to them. They had a center cap to go in. And for some reason, getting the nut started and bringing the center cap around just was problematic.
The fact that we were working on the floor didn't help. It should have been up on a work table. We could see what we were doing. And I can make excuses all day long for why it took me and Dan a whole show to put a set of center caps on a car, but that's the way it goes sometimes.
Oh, I've wasted time before on less challenging jobs. Ted's just not used to it.
You know, one thing I want to know right up front is if everybody saw that tear in Ted's eye when the car hit the ground. Because I'm pretty sure he was crying. Tears of joy. That was cool. Made me feel good. Really made Ted feel good.
The next step is to put the steering column in. Ted was really excited about that. Got that steering wheel on, and now he could sit on the milk crate and pretend he was driving his Daytona finally after all these years.
Well, I've walked past this car out in the salvage yard for years. And there's been countless times I've thought about what could be. And it was pretty sad to look at the way it was. And as the thing started, you kind of get sucked up into the deal here, whether you want to or not. It kind of takes on a life of its own. And to be a part of it has been a real thrill. It's a pleasure to work with a crew like this.
I thought this car would have gone faster than this.
I'm wondering what the reaction will be when that car debuts, because I think we'll have all of the pictures of the car in Ted's junkyard and as it's sitting before him. There'll be controversy over the car, which I kind of like, but I think that anybody that looks at the car would have to admit that was a great feat. It's a testimony to Auto Metal Direct, the metal products that they made. If they didn't build that product, I wouldn't have a business.
It doesn't take good news long to travel in the world of classic and muscle cars. Rumors of a Daytona restoration have been spreading for a few months, and no matter how high quality the car cover may be, it's never going to hide the shape of that iconic wing and nose from those who know muscle on four wheels.
Hey, everybody. Hey. Welcome to the Pittsburgh World of Wheels. My name is Dan Woods. I'm the host of Chop Cut Rebuild, and we want to thank you all for coming here. This car was originally found in a salvage yard in Alabama, and it had been sitting there for at least 25 years. You know, 25 years ago, there's no way this car was going to ever see the road again. It was strictly a parts car. But fortunately, Ted managed to keep enough of the car and enough of its integrity, including the VIN tag, that he could hang on to it. This car was involved in a high-speed chase with the police and hit a fire hydrant. And the damage was so bad on the front right that we're pretty sure it broke the left rear taillight. So let's not hold things up any further. Guys, you want to grab a corner of the cover?
The Daytona is a 1969 model. They built 503 of them. This car was originally a 444 barrel with a torque flight automatic.
This passes now. So here it is, ladies and gentlemen, the 1969 Daytona.
There's a strange appreciation for work in progress with classics. Maybe it's seeing things before they're covered with filler and paint, or maybe an understanding of the road left to travel. Whatever it is, this Daytona seemed to hit the mark.
Is there anything more iconic than this?
No, this
car?
Is it. We see this wing coming a mile away.
Right.
My name's Pam Beinecke, and this is?
Gary Beinecke. We are 71 Wing Cars. It's an original cast aluminum wing.
Okay, and how do you find something like that?
They're very hard to find. The wing of the car looks great. You know, Mark spent some time smoothing it out. These wings from the factory were cast rather crudely. You'd see pinholes and pits and gouges and scrapes and grinding marks on them when you stripped them, all the paint off of them from when they were original.
Mark Coates, ABM Restorations, Kingsport, Tennessee. Involvement was panel prep for all the Daytona specific parts, building the suspension components, assembly, and prepping it for show day.
The biggest challenge as far as the build on the car was acquiring all the Daytona specific parts, as they were all missing off the car. The wing, the nose, all the components of all that stuff, the rest of it's basically just 69 Charger, and the reproduction market is very good with what's available on that.
When we started the project with Chop Cut Rebuild, I really didn't realize, but along with our build that we were doing, Chop Cut was also filming the build of the Dodge Daytona. Then to get to see the pictures of what that Daytona looked like, and from building it for those pictures of a rusted Dodge Daytona that came out of a junkyard to what it is today, and really about the same time frame that we built the van, it's just it's hard to believe that you could do something like that quickly.
The decision for the paint was Mr. Hedrick, the gentleman, the CEO of AMD. He was insistent that the car looked like new metal out of the box. So when we did that came off so well with the stripe and stuff. It's been something that we've had a lot of positive comments on. It's a lot of fun to watch the people's response to looking at the pictures of the way the car was originally to where the car is now.
The appreciation for the Daytona and just having the history and knowing that it's a track car. And when they built them, I mean, they outlawed these things because they were so fast. In fact, I actually think now that they don't, like, you couldn't run them on a normal NASCAR circuit now because they would actually still win.
The original VIN plate is reattached to the frame on the Daytona. It is the original VIN plate off the car. It is still that car.
Jason King, I work with ABM Restorations and as well as with Ted Stevens at Stevens Performance. Status of the car with the VIN is a very late build of the model, so it's a very late production of the car. So coming into some of those parts are kind of difficult to find being so late because you're jumping into the next year model possibly.
We'll probably finish the car. That's we're going to have to finish the car. Like I said, everybody says you got to finish the car, so we'll have to finish the car.
There's two kinds of shows in automotive, trade shows and public shows. At trade shows, people are working, buying, selling, pitching new ideas or products. But at a public show, you find those who attend for the love of the rides. We thought we should experience a little of that love.
My name's Sean Yelanowitz, and I'm the show chairman of the Pittsburgh World of Wheels. This show's been in existence for 56 years. Like the title says, it's the World of Wheels. It's everything. It's a little bit of everything. We have street rods, we have customs, we have tuners, we have rat rods, we have traditional cars, we have cars that are just bone stock. My phone rang one day, and it was Dan Woods. And Dan said, hey, Sean, we want to come to Pittsburgh. We want to debut a couple of cars from our show. It's like a dream come true. Not often you get a TV show that wants to come and debut cars at your show. So we're fortunate enough to have Chop Cut Rebuild here. The Ford van behind us that was through Wyotech, that has really, I don't think anybody anticipated the excitement and the how well that was going to be received. They produce it, I'm getting number one.
So the World of Wheels has been in Pittsburgh, I think it's 56 years now. Wyotech's had a presence at this show probably for the last 10 years. We try to bring a vehicle down as much as we can. One of the neat things about this show is the ISCA World of Wheels Autorama shows have what they call Education Day on Fridays. And so they bring students and they bring them in and they let them have kind of the run of the show floor, if you want to call it that, on Fridays. But also from Wyotech's standpoint, we get a chance to sit down in front of them and kind of talk about the industry. It just was a good opportunity. So this show is not just to show off a nice, pretty van, but it really is to talk to youth and get them involved in what we do.
We start on next year's show Monday. Start getting celebrities together, start getting all the different displays together, contact with sponsors. Once we get that ball rolling, then we spend the summers going to outdoor shows, talking to car owners, and we have one in the show right now. It's in the process of being chopped.
Not just chopped by one of the greatest in the business. There's not many who ever could or can match this man's skill level.
I'm Gene Winfield. I'm from Mojave, California, and I've been chopping tops and building custom cars all my life, and I'm here in Pittsburgh to chop a top in the show while the show is going on. Well, for me, I don't build one from scratch. I customize existing vehicles. I chop tops, I French the headlights and taillights, and mold them and do all that. And then my most enjoyable part is painting them. See, I created the blending of paint, sometimes called the Winfield Fade.
You may know who created the Batmobile, but do you know who created Catwoman's car or 25 cars for Blade Runner? Well, you're looking at it.
My name is Justin Peck, and I'm a professional race car driver. So when I showed up, the first car that I saw was the van that was built by Wyotech. I think for me, one of the most impressive things is this thing has the Ford EcoTech twin turbo. So, I mean, it's pushing 320 horsepower to the wheels, which is like, it's incredible. I'm not surprised at the quality of Wyotech at all. I mean, I'm fortunate enough to have a Wyotech graduate that actually works for me. So guaranteed, the Wyotech guys, they're spot on, man. I mean, looking at the Harley that they built for this show, they know what they're doing, for sure.
The opportunity to do a build like this with Chop Cut Rebuild really is a great opportunity for the school itself. You know, we're always looking at opportunities to brand the school, to get the school's name out there in front of people. So when you have something like this where you do a build, you have a film crew come in, you put it on television, but it just kind of gives them an opportunity to see firsthand really what happens at the school. Because not only are we showing the van when we're doing, or the bike when we're doing these builds, but they're seeing the shops, and they get to see some of the things that are in the shops that they have an opportunity to work on.
You know, when a person leaves the show, when they walk out of here, I want them to get in the car and it become a debate. So what would you drive home? What, if you had one car, what would be the one car that you would want to take out of here? I want them to go, wow, I want to come back next year.
Coming back next year is a given for many who come to World of Wheels. In fact, I think some will be coming back year after year.
Season 12 of Chop Cut Rebuild has been our most ambitious to date. In just 13 episodes, we worked on four different vehicles. We even restored a motorcycle for the very first time. Then we moved on to Blairsville, Pennsylvania to work on a base transit van and turn it into the ultimate shaggin' wagon. Yes, I know restoration is what we should be about. So we took a 1969 Camaro and put it together. Of course, it never existed in 69. The entire car came out of catalogs and was put together. Now, the purists say you gotta rebuild something, so we found the ultimate in muscle cars from the 60s, a 1969 Dodge Daytona. So rare that they almost didn't want to let me weld on it, but I slipped the guy a few bucks and I got a few spot welds in, trust me. It's been a great season and a great joy for me to work on all these vehicles this year. We hope you've enjoyed it as well. Remember, if there's a classic in your life, don't ignore it, restore it. I'm Dan Woods. We'll see you next time on Chop Cut Rebuild.